स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम संजय सैनी। आई एम इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू विद द नेक्स्ट लेक्चर ऑफ फिजिक्स ऑफ क्लास 12। इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी स्टडीड फॉलोइंग टॉपिक्स। वी स्टडीड एसी सर्किट विद रजिस्टर, एसी सर्किट विद इंडक्टर। इन टूडेज लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी फॉलोइंग टॉपिक्स: एसी सर्किट विद कैपेसिटर एंड एसी सर्किट with a series combination of inductor, capacitor and resistance, and a very important phenomena of resonance in series LCR circuit, along with the study of quality factor of series LCR circuit. So dear students, I hope you have studied previous lectures carefully and you have made notes on these topics. So let us move to the next topic: AC circuit with capacitor. Yes students, this is an AC circuit with a capacitor. You know that capacitor is a device which is used to store charge. Capacitor may have any shape. Capacitor have the shape of in the form of parallel plate capacitors, spherical capacitors, cylindrical capacitor, and may have any other shapes also. But generally we discuss about parallel plate capacitor. Suppose we have a capacitor and the plates of that capacitors are connected to a source of alternating EMF. Say alternating EMF applied to the capacitor is E equals E naught sine omega t. It means that the potential difference is changing with respect to time. Now, when alternating EMF is applied to the capacitor, then charge is stored on the capacitor. We know that the EMF is alternating. It means for some time the EMF is positive and for some time it becomes negative, and it keeps on changing again and again. When this EMF applied to the capacitor is positive, means between this time interval 0 to T by 2. In this time interval, when the applied voltage is positive, then the charge stored on left plate of the capacitor will be positive and the charge stored on right plate will be negative. But when the voltage becomes negative between the time interval T by 2 to capital T, when the voltage is negative, in that case polarity of the charge stored on the capacitor also changes. Now the right plate becomes positive and left plate becomes negative. I mean to say that with the application of alternating EMF, alternating voltage, the charge stored on the capacitor is also changing. And because of the change of charge, because of the change in polarity or magnitude of the charge stored on the capacitor, the current is flowing through the capacitor. And that current is, we know that this current is the rate of change of charge. So let us see. This is applied voltage E equals E naught sine omega t. Now the charge stored on the capacitor is Q equals CV. Actually we read CV, but here the potential difference is E naught. So E naught sine omega t. So we use C in place of V, we use EMF E. So it is C E naught sine omega t. Now the current is rate of change of charge. We know that the current is rate of change of charge on the capacitor. So if we differentiate this charge with respect to time, then we obtain the instantaneous value of current in the circuit. So this current is flowing and this current is not constant. Between 0 to T by 2, charge is flowing in this direction, so current is in this direction. And between T by 2 to T, the charge flows in backward direction, so current also changes its polarity. So this keeps on going. So the current in the circuit is given by dq by dt, means the differentiation of derivative of q, and q is c e naught sine omega t we used here. If we differentiate this expression, then c e naught is a constant quantity and differentiation of sine is cos omega t, and differentiation of omega t is omega with respect to time. So we obtain this expression c e naught cos omega t multiplied by omega. So this is we obtain this, let me write from this you obtain this I current I is equal to C E naught omega into cos omega t. We obtained this expression. So this can be written as, this expression can be written as E naught divided by 1 over C omega, E naught divided by 1 over C omega into cos omega t. Here this is current. Now we know that on left hand side we have current, on right hand side we have this much quantity and cos omega t. We know that cos omega t is dimensionless, it does not have any dimension. Therefore this quantity must definitely have the dimensions of current. So if this is current, then the right hand side expression is also the current. So this quantity has the dimension of current. So let us write this as I naught. I naught means maximum current. Let us write this, it is maximum current I naught. So then I naught is means peak current in the circuit, that is equal to E naught divided by 1 over C omega. This is peak current. So now dear students, if this is current, this is EMF, then you know that this quantity should have dimension of resistance. So this is current, this is EMF. EMF is when divided by resistance, only then we can obtain current. So this quantity is some kind of resistance offered by the circuit, resistance offered by the capacitor. We cannot give this quantity the name resistance, because resistance is particularly used for opposition offered by resistors. So this opposition is offered by capacitor. We now say it capacitive reactance. We give this quantity a new name, capacitive reactance. So if I write this quantity XC, C is in denominator, C is suffix. So this is E naught upon XC, and XC we will call it capacitive reactance, and this will be equal to 1 over C omega. So we will discuss it. So if we wrote I naught in place of E naught over 1 by C omega, then the expression becomes I equals I naught cos omega t, and we converted cos omega t into sine omega t plus pi by 2, because initially the EMF is in the form of sine, so we want to obtain current also in the form of sine. Therefore we replace this by sine. Okay, we can write cos omega t by sine omega t plus pi by 2, because sine omega t plus pi by 2, then trigonometric ratio changes to cos, and this is second quadrant, so sine is positive in second quadrant, so sine omega t plus pi by 2 is definitely equal to cos omega t. Okay students, here we have seen that I naught equals E naught over 1 over C omega, and XC we call this quantity 1 over C omega as E naught by I naught, or this is denoted by XC, and XC is capacitive reactance, so its unit is ohm. So if somebody want to define capacitive reactance, then you can define it as capacitive reactance is the effective opposition offered by a capacitor to the flow of current through it. It is the opposition or resistance offered by a capacitor to the flow of current through it. So this is capacitive reactance, and its unit is ohm. And capacitive reactance, this has the formula XC, C suffix, it has the formula 1 over C omega, where C is capacitance and omega is angular frequency of the applied AC. Here this omega is same, angular frequency of the applied AC, and omega we know that this can be written as 2 pi by t. You can write omega as 2 pi divided by t, then t comes through numerator, this will become t, capital T over 2 pi c. Here capital T is the time period of this AC, time period of this AC, and if you write 1 by t as frequency, then you obtain the expression 1 over c into 2 pi nu, if nu is frequency and nu is equal to 1 over time period. So you can obtain this also. So this was related to capacitive reactance. Now you can see that the EMF has phase angle omega t. EMF has phase angle omega t, but the current has phase angle omega t plus pi by 2. Current has phase angle omega t plus pi by 2 at any time t. Then how much phase difference is there? There is a phase difference of pi by 2. This is the phase difference. And which quantity is leading? The current has the larger phase angle than EMF. Current is leading the voltage by an angle pi by 2 radian. So current leads the EMF by pi by 2 radian. So if both quantities are changing, so let me draw waveform for you. If both quantities are changing, say this is the waveform for voltage, and this is the waveform for EMF, say E. And if we draw the waveform for current, for this current, then current leads the voltage. Current has the extra phase angle of pi by 2 as compared to EMF. So the graph will look like this. This will be the waveform for, and this much angle is pi by 2. So this pink one graph is for current, and this purple one graph is for EMF E. So you can see that current leads the voltage by an angle pi by 2. This is very important phase relationship between current and voltage in capacitor. So these are the waveform which you can see. This is blue one is for EMF, and pink, red, orange one is for current. So this is clear to you, I think so. Now let us draw phasor diagram. So it is very easy to make phasor diagram. First you draw two axes. This is x axis, this is y axis. Now first you draw the phasor for E. Phasor for E is say this one. This is a phasor of E. This total length is E naught, and the angle it makes with x axis is omega t. This is phasor for this line. This vector is a phasor for EMF. Then the phasor for current. The current has a phase angle of omega t plus pi by 2, means it is pi by 2 ahead than EMF. So you draw a line at an angle pi by 2, means 90 degree with EMF. So this will be the phasor of current. This will be peak current I naught, and its phase angle will be omega t plus 90 degree. This is 90 degree, and earlier it was omega t. So the total angle will be omega t plus pi by 2. So this will be the phasor diagram for EMF and current in case of pure capacitor. So this is phasor for EMF, this is phasor for current, and the angle between them is pi by 2. So this was a topic. Now let us see the variation of inductive reactance with frequency. How does the inductive reactance vary with the change in frequency of the applied AC? You applied AC alternating current with frequency say nu. Suppose you increase the frequency of applied AC. Now there are more number of cycles completed in the same time. This has the frequency greater than the earlier. Nu 2 is greater than nu 1. So if you increase the frequency of applied AC, then what is the effect on inductive reactance? We know that inductive reactance means reactance offered by an inductor has the formula L omega, and omega is 2 pi into nu, means frequency. So we can see that the inductive reactance means the opposition offered by inductor to the flow of current is directly proportional to the frequency of the applied AC. So if the applied AC is having more frequency, then the inductor would offer the larger opposition to the flow of current. And if the applied AC has lesser frequency, then the inductive reactance would be smaller. So it is directly proportional to the inductive to the frequency of the applied AC. So if you plot a graph between inductive reactance and frequency, here on y axis say inductive reactance, on x axis say frequency of applied AC, then the graph will look like a straight line. because it is directly proportional. And slope of graph means tan theta. If this is angle theta, then slope of graph will be equal to 2 pi L, because we have seen the expression XL equals to 2 pi L nu. This is the inductive reactance. So if this is an equation of straight line, and this much is the slope of the graph. So this is slope. So let us see what is written here. So these expressions we have already seen, and I have here the frequency is represented by small f is the frequency, but earlier I represented the frequency by nu, by a letter nu. So this doesn't make any difference. So inductive reactance is directly proportional to the frequency of the applied AC. So this is the variation, the graph between this. Now one more important thing: suppose you have applied direct current to a inductor. Direct current, this is inductor of inductance L, and this is direct current of EMF E naught, say E. Now what happens? What is the inductive reactance? Dear students, for DC, the frequency of DC is zero, because direct current does not change. Direct current is always constant in magnitude and direction. Direct current does not change, so its frequency is zero. So if its frequency is zero, then opposition offered by the inductor would also be zero, because opposition offered by the inductor is L omega, L into 2 pi nu. So if frequency is zero, then inductive reactance is also zero. It means that inductor does not offer any opposition to the flow of direct current through it. Inductor does not oppose the flow of direct current through itself. So direct current can flow without any opposition, without any resistance through an inductor. So this is very, very important fact. Now let us see how does the capacitive reactance vary with the frequency of applied AC. We have seen the expression for capacitive reactance as XC equals 1 over C omega. This was the expression for angle for capacitive reactance, and omega is equal to 2 pi nu. Here nu is the frequency of applied AC. So you can see from this expression that capacitive reactance, it means opposition offered by capacitor, is inversely proportional to the frequency of applied AC. So if you increase the frequency, then the opposition offered by capacitor decreases, and if you decrease the frequency, then the opposition offered by capacitor increases. So this is the variation of capacitive reactance with applied AC. So this is the expression. If you see the graph, then it is inversely proportional. So the graph for inversely proportional quantities looks like this. Now, very important term, that inductor cannot decrease direct current. So it means inductor cannot oppose direct current. Through inductor, direct current flows without any opposition. It can only decrease alternating current. And second thing, capacitor allows AC to flow through it but blocks DC. Capacitor does not allow DC to pass through itself, because for direct current the frequency is zero, for DC the frequency is zero. If frequency is zero, then capacitive reactance becomes infinity, because capacitive reactance is inversely proportional to frequency. If frequency is zero, then capacitive reactance becomes infinity. So direct current cannot pass through capacitor. So capacitor blocks DC, and it allows only AC to pass through itself. AC circuit with L, C, R in series combination. Now we will see a series combination of inductor, capacitor and resistance. Now we have a series combination of inductor, capacitor and resistance. Dear students, if these three quantities, these three devices are in series combination, then equal current flows through all of them. Now the current flowing through all the components, inductor, capacitor and resistor, it's same. But the EMF developed across, but the potential dropped across these components would be different. So same current is flowing because they are in series, but different voltages are dropped across three components, and the sum of the three voltages would be equal to applied voltage. Suppose when current I flows through the circuit, then VL is the potential dropped across inductor, VC is the potential drop across capacitor, and VR is the potential dropped across resistors. Then what will be VL equal to? Potential dropped across inductor would be equal to I into XL. XL is inductive reactance, I is current. Current, suppose the current through the circuit is I. Then what would be VC? VC would be I into XC, and VR means voltage dropped across resistor, that would be equal to V into R. V multiplied by resistance. So these are the three potential dropped across three components. So if we see a phasor diagram of the circuit using phasor diagram, then you will see that because the current is same in all the components, therefore we can take current as a reference vector. Students, current is same in all three components, so I am taking current as a reference vector. Say this is current I, but the voltages are different in different components. Voltages are different in different magnitudes, as well as they are different in directions, phase angles also. But we know that in a resistor, voltage and current are always in same phase. So if we have represented current in this direction, then definitely we will have to represent VR, means potential drop across the resistor, in this direction only. So let us say that this much is VR, means potential drop across resistor. If current is in this direction, then potential drop across the resistance will also be in this direction, because current and voltage are in same phase in resistor. And now, how do we represent VL now? We know that in an inductor, current lags behind the voltage by an angle pi by 2. You can recall this topic. We have seen earlier that in an inductor, current and voltage have phase difference of pi by 2, and current lags behind the voltage. Voltage has the pi by 2 more phase angle as compared to current. So if current is lagging behind, it means voltage is ahead of current by an angle pi by 2. So if I have represented current in this direction, then in which direction should I represent the VL? Should I represent potential drop across inductor? If current is this in this direction, then voltage is leading the current by an angle pi by 2 in case of inductor. So I will represent VL along this direction. Say this is VL, potential drop across inductor. It is pi by 2, it is leading by an angle pi by 2, leading the current by an angle pi by 2. So this is representation for phasor of VL. Now let us draw phasor of VC. We have studied that in a capacitor, current leads the voltage by an angle pi by 2. In a capacitor only, forget about inductor or resistor, in a capacitor only, today itself we have studied this. In a capacitor, current leads the voltage by an angle pi by 2. So current I leads the voltage VC by an angle pi by 2. It means VC is behind current. So if I draw the phasor for VC, then this will be phasor diagram for VC. it is lagging behind the current because current leads the voltage VC. So these three are the phasors. This is phasor, this phasor, and this is also phasor. These three are the phasors. So let us see now in this diagram. In case of resistor, current and voltage are in same direction. In inductor, current lags behind the voltage. Voltage is ahead of conductor by an angle pi by 2 current. Okay, in case of capacitor, current leads the voltage by an angle pi by 2. So these four are the phasors. This is phasor for current, this is phasor for VR, this is phasor for VL, and this is phasor for VC. Okay, students. Now let us draw the resultant. We know that these two phasors are opposite to each other. VL and VC, these two phasors are opposite to each other. VL and VC are just opposite. So this is these can be subtracted. If this VC is smaller as compared to VL, then we can subtract VC from VL because these are very exactly opposite to each other. So if we plot VC in negative, then it is negative VC. Then the resultant of VL and VC would be VL minus VC. So this the resultant is, now this one is the resultant, because the VL and VC are opposite to each other. If VC is small, then the resultant of VL and VC would be VL minus VC. So this small one is the resultant of VL and VC, and this one is VR. So now we have two phasors only. One is VR and other is VL minus VC. Now what is its resultant? I earlier told you that resultant of three voltages would be equal to EMF, applied EMF E. We have applied EMF. You can see that we have applied EMF E equals E naught sin omega t. So resultant of these three, VL, VC, VR, will be equal to E. So resultant can be obtained using Pythagoras theorem. It is VL minus VC and it is VR, and resultant of these two will be equal to, using Pythagoras theorem, this will be equal to square root of VR square plus VL minus VC square. So this is equal to EMF E. So this is very important relation. This is very, very important relation. And if we find the value of current flowing through the circuit, then current, we know that it is equal to current is equal to EMF divided by resistance. So how can we reach to this expression? So we have a slight 1-2 steps behind this. If I represent VR as IR, if I write VL as IXL and VC as IXC square, then this I square is common everywhere. So we can take this I square outside from the sign of square root, then what remains inside is R square plus XL minus XC whole square. So this quantity becomes equal to EMF E, and then I becomes equal to E divided by this comes to denominator, and I becomes equal to E upon square root of R square plus XL minus XC whole square. Now this is current, this is EMF, then this is definitely something like resistance. So this quantity has the dimensions of resistance, and we gave this a new name, impedance. This quantity is given a new name, impedance, and this is represented by letter Z. So this is Z is equal to square root of R square plus XL minus XC whole square, and this is known as impedance of the circuit. And its definition is again very easy. Impedance is the effective opposition offered by a circuit to the flow of current through itself. I am repeating. Impedance is the effective opposition offered by a circuit to the flow of current through itself. And this impedance is represented by Z, and its expression is equal to square root of R square plus XL minus XC whole square. Now we know that XL is equal to L omega and XC is equal to 1 over C omega. So we replace this also. And Z becomes equal to E upon I also. E is EMF and I is current. So this is instantaneous value of EMF. This is instantaneous value of current. So if you divide these two values, then also you obtain effective opposition of the circuit. Suppose you divide maximum value by maximum value. So you are dividing peak current by peak EMF by peak current. Then also you can obtain EMF of the circuit. Sorry, impedance of the circuit. So this is impedance. Now the angle between these two means what is the phase angle, phase difference between EMF and current. What is the phase difference? Here you can see that EMF is along this direction and current is along this direction. Then what is the angle between these two quantities? Angle between these two quantities is phi. Then this phi will be equal to tan phi is equal to perpendicular divided by base. Perpendicular we have VL minus VC and base we have VR. So tan phi means tangent of phase difference between current and EMF is equal to VL minus VC divided by VR. So tan phi is equal to VL minus VC divided by VR. If you replace VL minus VC by I XL minus XC and VR by IR, then I cancel with R, tan phi becomes equal to XL minus XC divided by R. So this is tangent of the phase difference, and phase difference phi will be equal to, you can take tangent to that side and you can calculate phase difference phi. Special cases. Suppose XL and XC are equal. It means inductive reactance is equal to capacitive reactance. Means L omega is equal to 1 over C omega. In that case, XL is greater than XC. Means inductive reactance is greater than capacitive reactance. L omega is greater than 1 upon C omega. In that case, this quantity tan phi will be positive. If XL is greater than XC, then this quantity is positive. Positive means EMF leads the current. EMF leads the current by an angle phi in series LCR circuit. Now case 2, if XL is less than XC, that is L omega is less than 1 over C omega, then tan phi will be negative. This quantity will be negative. Negative means here EMF lags behind the current. Okay. If XL is greater than XC, in that case this is EMF E and this is current I, and phi is positive. This is first case for this one. And if XC is greater than XL, then this is the case. Current leads and EMF lags behind by an angle phi. Now the third one is, if XL equals XC, means both the reactances are equal, inductive reactance is equal to capacitive reactance, in that case this quantity is 0. And if this quantity is 0, then tan phi will be equal to 0. Therefore E and I both are in same phase. E and I both are in same phase. So if this is 0, then current and EMF are in same phase, and impedance does not depend upon frequency of applied AC. Impedance becomes independent of frequency, because impedance, we know that impedance Z is equal to square root of R square plus L omega minus 1 by C omega whole square. If these two becomes equal, L omega becomes equal to 1 by C omega, then in that case Z becomes minimum, and that minimum Z becomes equal to square root of R square, or you can say R. In that case impedance of the circuit becomes equal to applied resistance. So in that case impedance becomes independent of L omega, independent of 1 by C omega. It becomes dependent only and only on resistance of the resistor. So this particular situation is also known as resonance in AC circuit. This situation is called resonance in AC circuit. Dear student, this is very, very important concept, resonance in AC circuit. When does this happen, resonance? This happens when inductive reactance becomes equal to capacitive reactance. It means L omega becomes equal to 1 by C omega and tan phi becomes equal to 0 and phi becomes equal to 0. So these are the conditions for obtaining resonance in series LCR circuit. In that case, impedance of the circuit becomes minimum and it becomes equal to applied resistance. So if the resonance has been obtained in the circuit, then in that case the impedance of series LCR circuit becomes equal to resistance, and current in the circuit, peak current in the circuit, has becomes maximum. So we can see that peak current is equal to peak EMF divided by Z. And if resonance has occurred, if this condition has been obtained, then Z is at minimum value, and minimum value of Z is equal to resistance. Then in that case, peak current itself has obtained a maximum value, and that maximum value of peak current will be equal to E naught divided by R. So at resonance of series LCR circuit, peak current becomes maximum because impedance has become minimum, and that maximum peak current will be equal to E naught divided by R. R is the resistance. So the impedance offered by the circuit is minimum and current is maximum. This condition is called resonance condition of series LCR circuit, and the frequency is called resonance frequency. And the frequency at which the frequency of applied AC at which XL has become equal to XC, it means L omega has become equal to 1 over C omega. It means L omega has become equal to 1 over C omega. That frequency is equal to, you can see that will be equal to 1 over root LC. That angular frequency is known as resonance frequency. So if this is 1 over root LC, then you can write omega naught as 2 pi nu naught. So you can obtain in terms of frequency also. This is angular frequency, you can obtain frequency also. So frequency will be equal to resonance frequency will be equal to 1 over 2 pi root LC. So this is very easy to be obtained. We equated XL and XC. XL is equal to L omega and XC is 1 over C omega. So solving this, omega square is equal to 1 over LC and omega is equal to 1 over root LC, and I replaced omega by 2 pi nu. 2 pi nu is equal to 1 by root LC, and you take 2 pi to the denominator, nu becomes equal to 1 by 2 pi root LC. So this will be the expression for angular frequency of applied AC at resonance. We have studied this. Now we have a resonance curve. Dear students, we will study this topic tomorrow. We have studied circuit with pure capacitor, circuit with series combination of inductor, capacitor and resistance, and we have seen different conditions of series LCR circuit. Inductor dominant circuit in which XL is greater than XC, in that EMF leads the current by an angle phi. Capacitor dominant circuit in which XC is greater than XL, and in that case EMF lags behind the current by an angle phi. And third one is resonance LCR circuit. In resonance, XL becomes equal to XC and the impedance of the circuit becomes minimum, and that minimum impedance is equal to resistance, and peak current becomes maximum. So that is the case of resonance LCR circuit. So we will discuss about resonant curve and quality factor in our next lecture. So dear students, you keep on watching the videos, keep on making the notes, you read from your NCERT books, textbook and other, from all other resources which you have along with you. Don't waste time in reading the useless study material and reading from different platforms which cannot benefit you. So you keep on watching my videos and keep on concentrated. so you will definitely be able to clear your doubts. If you find any doubt, then we can discuss in Google Meet or any other platform. So for the next next video, till then, stay home, stay safe. Thank you very much.